Father, we worship you and we thank you for who you are, God. We give you this time this morning. And Lord, we just say, have your way, Holy Spirit. And we give this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Step, I collide with you like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. You cannot fail. The only thing I've found is through it all, you never let me down. You don't hold back, relentless in pursuit. And every turn, I come face to face with you. Yes, Lord. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce.
Yes, Lord.
Chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. Could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Thank you, Lord. Your love is fierce.
Can we give a shout to God this morning? Thank you for your great love, O Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Can we just lift our hands to heaven this morning as we just worship and praise him? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Worship you, Lord.
And you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Oh, can we say that one more time?
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you, and you are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you, and you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. Touching every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you.
You are
waymaker, miracle worker, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here.
You are here, turning lives around. We worship.
We lift you up.
You are here, mending every heart. We worship you. We worship you. Yeah. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
You never stop, you never stop working.
Thankful that what God does in our life is not dictated by our feelings. Amen. The Word of God is full of His promises. They are yes and amen for us to hang on to and grab a hold of. Scripture is there to guide us and lead us in all things. And God, we are thankful this morning that we have someone who is faithful as you. Even when we are faithless, you remain faithful, for you cannot deny yourself, because that's just who you are. You cannot deny the fact that you are faithful. Well, Father, we have come to celebrate you this morning, to celebrate your goodness, to celebrate everything that you are doing in our lives. And we just worship you this morning. How many believes that God is good this morning? Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord. I know your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life, and all my life, you have been faithful. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yes.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Your goodness.
Your goodness is running out. running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Can we sing that one more time?
Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. So my life, you have been faithful. So my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life, all my life, you have been faithful. So my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. One more time. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Ooh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You just praise the Lord this morning if he's been good to you. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. 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 Lord, you are great and greatly to be praised. Oh, can we just take a moment just to worship him? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Father. Bless you, Lord. Lord, we ask for an open heaven this morning. We ask for an open heaven this morning. We pray that heaven would touch earth this morning.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, kiss your people this morning.
Yes.
Let your fire fall.
Yes.
Lord, we just magnify
you.
We worship you. We worship you.
Yes.
We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord.
Yes.
you're here this morning, maybe you don't feel like worshiping. You don't feel like praising. We've all been there, right? We have been. Let's be honest this morning. It's okay, but you know what? You do it anyways as a sacrifice of praise. Amen? We are compelled by faith, not by our feelings. Amen? Lord, we worship you this morning. We give you praise. Lord, you're so good. Lord, let the fire fall, let the fire fall. Oh, come on, church. We're just going to take a moment to worship him. The bridegroom wants to hear from you, the voice of the bride. Lord, we love you, oh God. We worship you, Lord. There's no one like you. No one like our God.
Yes.
Thank you, Father, that you lead us into good green pastures, Lord. Beside the still waters. Thank you, Lord. In the valley of the shadow of death, you're with us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. We worship you, we worship you. Worship you, Lord.
Jesus.
Just let him speak to you this morning. Just let him speak to you this morning. The Good Shepherd wants to speak to you this morning. We're quieting ourselves for just a moment. Be still and know that I am God.
You bring light to the darkness.
wish someone would help me worship the Lord this morning.
We lift you up, Father. We praise you, Lord.
On all the earth. This morning, we just lift you up above our circumstance, above everything that would try to exalt itself above you this morning, oh God. You are high, lifted up, seated in heavenly places. You're King of all. Heaven is your throne, the earth is your footstool. There is no one, there's nothing bigger than our God. Great are you, Lord. We worship you this morning. We for just the next few moments just continue to worship him for a second, to exalt him. The best is yet to come. Amen?
Amen.
God has good things for your life, for your family. Don't doubt your calling, your purpose. Mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, worship you, Lord.
You are exalted, Lord. You are high and lifted up. Nothing greater than you, nothing higher. Your thoughts are higher than ours. Your ways are higher than ours. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We celebrate you this morning, Lord. You give us the victory, 'cause we are more than conquerors through Christ who loves us. More than conquerors.
Yes, Lord. Worship you, Lord.
Uh, So today for Pastor Appreciation, we wanted to have a time of prayer for Pastor Robert and Kim and Jim and their family. So if they don't mind coming up to the front. And then I know we might not want to lay hands on them, but if you want to gather around them so that we can pray for them. Everybody want to come? They don't bite. Well, Robert might. I don't think Jim and Kim will yet. All right, so we'll go ahead and we'll pray for them, and then we'll pray for the service that's coming up. Lord, we pray that your anointing would rest upon Jim and Kim and on Pastor Robert and on the Kaminsky family as a whole, God. We pray that you would lead them and guide them, God, that you would give them direction and wisdom, God, that your spirit would fill them up as they pour themselves out to you, God, that they would have a constant cycle of your spirit flowing through their lives, Lord, that you would have them know without a doubt that you are there with them through every high and through every low, and that you have made us, as Pastor Jim said, more than conquerors through you. Help us to keep that in mind no matter what we face. We pray that your anointing would continue to be with them and lead them and guide them in the path that they take. In Jesus' name, amen. If anybody else wants to say a special prayer, Larry, I can tell you want to.
Anytime. Yes, within season, out of season.
You don't need the mic?
But I just want to say that I just want to honor
my wife this morning. I'm not going to say anything long, but you, if it's not for you, I couldn't do what I do. I mean, all of our wives, us husbands, we probably say that, right? Behind the scenes, our wives are there. And so I just want to thank you. I mean, seriously. She is a woman of God. Yeah. All right, well, if you want to take your Bibles out and turn with me to Psalm 23, we've been talking about the Good Shepherd. We've been experiencing the Good Shepherd, amen? And today we're going to finish up by looking at verses 4 to 6 in Psalm 23. As you're turning there, I'm going to just go ahead and pray. Father, thank you so much for who you are. And I pray that as we look into your word this morning, Holy Spirit, would you give us eyes to see and ears to hear what you would say to us? Lord, if there's anyone here this morning who has a distorted view of the Father because of life, maybe an absentee father, or maybe a husband or a spouse or a parent that maybe was distorted in the image of you, God, I pray this morning that that distorted image would become clear. And God, that you would have your way, speak to your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. and he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Wow, that's good. That is good. Again, last week we looked at verses 1 to 3. Today we're going to finish up by looking at verses 4 to 6. Again, I'd like to read them again. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This morning, number one, I want us to see here in Psalm 23, the valley spoken of. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I want to first of all say that it's the shadow of death. It is not the valley of death. Whatever you walk through in life, Jesus is there to lead you and to guide you through. Let's just put that to rest. Amen? And here's the good news this morning, if you might find yourself in the valley, or whenever you do find yourself in the valley, that where there is a shadow, there is a light. Amen? Where there is a shadow, there is a light. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Times in life, we see what appears to be death. But listen, God is with you to guide you. Where there is a shadow, there is a light. Jesus is the light of the world. Amen? Amen. John 8:12 says again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. The valley. We also see in this passage of scripture, number two, we see the peace here. In verse 4b, I will fear no evil. The days that we live in, they are evil. But listen, God has called the church to be the church. Through this crisis, this pandemic, God has called the church to be the church. He has called the church to be the place for answers, the place for hope, the place for restoration, the place of life. The place for peace. There's a lot of anxiety out there in the world today, and the church of Jesus Christ is where we find peace. The Lord Jesus Christ. I will fear no evil. Isaiah 41:10, in the Amplified, I love it. It says this, do not fear anything, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I'm your God this morning. Not just God up there somewhere. He is your God. He is my God. Amen? We say that together? He is my God. He's my God. Amen? For you're with me. You're my God. I will strengthen you. Be assured I will help you. I will certainly take hold of you with my righteous right hand. This is the good stuff. A hand of justice, of power, of victory, and of salvation. That's what the Amplified version says. So in the valley, we see that God is not only with us, but his right hand of blessing is there with us. And it is a hand of justice. It is a hand of power. It is a hand of victory. And it is a hand of salvation. Right now, we seem to be in dark times, but there is a light that is among us that's leading us out of this dark time. Amen? Talk about social justice. Jesus is the ultimate man that was social justice. He is just and he is loving and he is good. And he has the power to lead us and to guide us through. So we see the peace that is in the valley. Number three this morning, we see the presence. Verse 4c, for you are with me. You're with me. Hebrews 13:5 says, don't love money. Be satisfied with what you have. For God has said, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. That's the New Living Translation. See, in the valley, God is with us. The good shepherd is there to lead his children through. And listen, what God leads you to He will lead you through. What he leads you to, he will lead you through, no matter what it looks like. So in the valley, we need to be aware, we need to be content, and we need to be yielded to God. We need to be aware that God is there. We need to be content with what we have in that moment. We need to be yielded or humble. Again, remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, "Not my will, but your will be done." 1 Timothy 6:6-7 says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." It will be hard to see the Father move in your life when we are discontent. It's hard to see him move when we feel like we don't have enough. God is enough. "But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it." You probably heard this saying, but I've never seen a U-Haul behind a hearse. We've brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out, except for making an impact in somebody's life. The only thing we take to heaven with us is souls, right? So again, do not love money. Be satisfied with what you have, for God said, "I will never fail you. I'll never abandon you." The key there is being content, though, in those moments. Hebrews 13:5 in the Amplified says this, "I will never under any circumstances desert you, nor give you up, nor leave." It almost sounds like that song. Never gonna give you up. I'm sorry. He won't. Never gonna let you down. He won't desert you. I'm sorry. I don't know. Come on. Shout out to the 80s music. I don't know. "I'll never under any circumstances desert you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support. Nor will I in any degree leave you helpless, nor will I forsake you or let you down, or relax my hold on you." Assuredly not. We see the presence of the Good Shepherd. And that is a promise of God. He's never leave us, and he will never forsake us. Number four this morning, we see the comfort in this passage of Scripture. Verse 4D, "Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." In Amplified, it says, "Your rod to protect and your staff to guide. They comfort and they console me." You know, Scripture says, "Whom the Lord loves, he chastens," right? He disciplines those that he loves because he's trying to guide us and direct us and teach us. Just like us as parents, when we discipline our children, or we have children, we discipline them. Believe it or not, we don't like that. It does hurt us. But we do it because we want you to equate wrong decisions with the pain that comes with it. See, there's a cost to sin. There's a cost to wrong choices. And God wants to teach us something. And in the tough times of life, God is growing us. Amen? He's growing us. His rod and his staff there in the valley to protect us, to guide us, to comfort and to console us and to discipline us. But he's taking us somewhere. Amen? He's taking us somewhere. Let me just say, in those moments where the Lord is trying to guide us and correct us and teach us, we must be teachable. Listen, pride and rebellion. We see what had happened to Lucifer when he gave into it. And I just want to say this morning, if pride and if rebellion can make a devil out of an angel, what can it do to us? Amen? Or oh my. We need to be yielded to God. And know that the rod and the staff, they're there to comfort us. It's there to guide us. Because us as parents, you know, we may have disciplined our child, but our children always know that we love them and we're there for them. And when they need us, we're there. Same thing with the Father. So this morning we see the valley, we see the peace, we see the presence, we see the comfort. And number five, we see the preparation. Verse 5a, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." This really starts to get good here. Think about that for a second. You prepare, the Lord prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemies. Think about the battlefield, right? Because in life, it's like a battle that we're in. How many of us would like to just sit there and eat a meal, right, in the middle of battle? But the Lord comes and he prepares a table before us. And he has a table set up and he's sitting there and he wants us to take a moment and to sit with him. To be still and know that he is God. In those moments he's counseling us, he's comforting us, he's encouraging us. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What is he saying this morning? That in your greatest battle, God's not left you. He's pulled out all the stops. He's brought all the good stuff with him. You see, God knows the end from the beginning. Jesus said, I am the first and I am the last. He has made preparations for you in the valley long before you found yourself there. And those preparations are at the table. And we've got to sit down at that table. And we need to commune with the Father. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Listen, this morning I just came by to encourage you. Don't worry about tomorrow because God is already there. Don't worry about tomorrow because God is already there. Again, what should be our attitude or our posture in the valley? It's total dependence on him. I mean, actually, that should be our posture in life, regardless. Total dependence on him. Again, the times that are difficult in life, I mean, let's say it this way. God doesn't always make it easy because he's growing us. He wants us to depend on him. We walk by faith and not by sight. I want to read this verse 5 in the message, and this is amazing. This is what it says in the message in Psalm 23, 5. It says, you serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Not just a three-course meal. Hey, this is not Olive Garden. He's taking you. I don't know what's better than Olive Garden. I don't know. Amen. We're talking six. Well, we'll say lunch and dinner. There you go. No. Six-course meal. What you need is there. Listen, today we do not have a heavenly father who is a neglectful one. We serve a good father. It's not cliche. It's not just the song that we sing. He really is good. One that provides for his kids. You're his kids this morning. You are. You're his kids. The Passion Translation says this in John 14. Remember when Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey my commands? This is what the Passion Translation says. Loving me empowers you to obey my commands. Ooh, that's good. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another Savior, the Holy Spirit of truth, who will be to you a friend just like me. And he will never leave you. The world won't receive him because they can't see him or know him. But you will know him intimately. Because he will make his home in you and will live inside of you. In verse 18, I promise, this is Jesus talking, I promise that I will never leave you helpless or abandon you as orphans. I will come back for you. I will come back to you. I'm going to read that one more time. I promise that I will never leave you helpless or abandon you as orphans. I will come back to you. Jesus was about to leave. And he was assuring the disciples that he wasn't going to leave them alone. The Holy Spirit was him coming back to us. And I tell you, there's a day that's coming soon. It's called our blessed hope. Christ is coming back again. He's coming back again to be king, a righteous king, a just king. So this morning, I want you to know that you're not orphans. You're not. Don't think that way. Don't act that way. You're not orphans. You're God's kids. We then move on to verse 5b where it says, you anoint my head with oil. We see the anointing, obviously. We see the anointing. We also see here authority, right? Because when they anointed the king, they poured oil over their head. When they anointed them king, David, all over his head, running down. And we also see the blessing in the anointing. You anoint my head with oil. Matter of fact, I just want to read something over here in Psalm 133. I felt the Lord speak this to me this morning. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the precious oil upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garments. It is like the dew of Hermon, descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing. There is the place of unity. There the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Listen, this morning, there is life, there is blessing and unity. That's why the enemy wants to come against God's people so much, so bad, create disunity. The blessing, the anointing flows in that place. You anoint my head with oil. For a moment, I just want to talk about what does that word mean in the Hebrew, anoint. This is so good. It means to be fat or to grow fat, not physically, but in context, but to grow fat, to become fat, to become prosperous, to make or be made fat, to fatten oneself of Jehovah's sword. To fatten yourself with the goodness of God. To be full. That's what he's saying. To be full. You anoint my head with oil. And then we see the overflow. My cup runs over. Listen this morning, guys. We serve a God who's more than enough. More than enough. Last time I checked, God is still called Jehovah Jireh. The Lord, my provider. We see the favor. We see the flavor too. We are the salts of the earth. The favor. It goes on to say in verse 6a, it says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Not maybe, not if it works out, but there's this word here, surely. It's almost like this sense of urgency or the sense of passion. Surely, goodness and mercy. You can almost imagine David thinking back on the faithfulness of God, being encouraged by the Lord in that moment. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Hebrew, that word follow, and we're talking about the goodness and mercy following us. This is what that word follow means. To follow after, to run after. To pursue, to put to flight, to chase, almost like a dog chases. That's how goodness and mercy is going to follow you. To attend closely upon, to persecute or to harass, figuratively, to pursue ardently, to aim eagerly, to secure. Just like that song that we sang this morning, your goodness is running after me. Right? That's what this verse is saying here. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. They'll harass me. They'll come after me. It's going to pursue me. It's going to chase me like a dog chases the mailman, right? Or used to chase the mailman. Surely goodness and mercy is going to follow me all the days of my life. But this is the thing. You got to stay walking with the shepherd. Amen? You got to stay walking with the shepherd. And lastly, this morning, we see the place. Tim, would you mind? Was Tim in here anywhere? No? Okay, that's fine. I was asking him to play the piano, but that's fine. The place. Lastly, it ends like this. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. For those who have put their faith in Christ, heaven is our final destination. Amen? Home. It's home. Paul said, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:8, it says in the New Living Translation, yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. Absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 27:4, this is where we're going to be ending this morning. David, the same one that wrote Psalm 23, wrote this portion of the psalm. And he said, one thing I have asked of the Lord, and that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, in his presence, all the days of my life. To gaze upon the beauty, the delightful loveliness and majestic grandeur of the Lord and to meditate in his temple. One thing I've asked of the Lord, and that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord and in his presence all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty, the delightful loveliness and majestic grandeur of the Lord and to meditate in his temple. What was it about the presence of the Lord that David so craved and so desired? It's that same presence that walks in the good and the bad, that prepares a table in the presence of our enemies. Listen, as we walk through life and we come in contact with and we come into the presence of our enemies, there is another presence which is greater, which comes and overshadows in those moments. Could we just stand together as we close? Last week, I concluded by reading Psalm 23 in the Message Bible, verses 1 to 3. And I want to finish that up this morning, reading 4 to 6. I just love how it just kind of puts it out there. Amen. God, my shepherd, I don't need a thing. You have bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I'm not afraid when you walk at my side. Your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. Wow. God is even displaying to the whole world how good he is. Devil can't do that. No, he wants to make you starve. He wants you to die. But on the other hand, here comes our good God serving a six-course dinner right in front of our enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Overflow. Listen, if you want that overflow, you've got to be in an attitude of contentment. In verse 6, your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life. Could we just close our eyes for just a moment? And as we do that, I just want us to take a moment to just come between us and God. Take a moment, get alone with God. Maybe you've been away from his house for a long time. Maybe not even the physical church building, but maybe you've just been away from him, from his presence. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to come back home. This morning, maybe you've kind of backslidden away from God and you just kind of wake up today and you're like, how did I get here? Well, I'll say today is the day to come back. God loves you. He wants to chase after you with his love and his favor. But you got to let him. You got to be right with him to get what is your dad's. When the prodigal son was away out of the house of his dad, he ended up eating in the pig slop with the pigs. He could not access what was the father's, which really was his, because he was an heir, because he was not in his father's house anymore. Today is the day to come back. If you're here today and you want to give your life back to God, it's between you and God right now. I want you just to slip up your hand just to heaven. It's a sign of surrender. Say, God, I just feel I need to. You could be saved for a long time. It could be a short time. There is nothing, there's no shame in this. Matter of fact, we're getting rid of our shame. If you're here this morning, you're like, I need to get back to the house of God. I need to get back to the Lord, to his family, to my father's house. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of rooms. A big, big table. If that's you, just slip your hand up as an act of surrender to the Lord. Maybe you're here this morning, maybe you never gave your life to Christ before. The Bible says that sin separates us from God. But Jesus came and he died that you might have life, that you might have a relationship restored to the Father and have eternal life. The Bible says for the wages or the payment of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. This morning, God wants to give you the free gift of salvation, but it's going to cost you surrendering your life to Him. But when you do that, I promise you, you will find life. There's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. And God wants you to come home this morning. If you're here and you say, hey, Pastor Jim, I want that gift of salvation. I want to give my life to Christ. Just lift your hand up. It's free. It's available to you. All right. Father, I thank you. I thank you for your goodness and your mercy, and I just pray, God, that you would continue to walk with your people. I just speak the blessings of God. I declare and I pray for, and I just bless your home with household salvations. For those that need provision, God, I pray they would trust you with their finances, and that, God, they would even receive unexpected checks in the mail, God, that you would bless them and provide for them. I also bless, God, each and every one of us, that, God, that we would be extravagant givers, Lord, because you said for God so loved the world that he gave. And that's more than just finances, too. That we would sacrifice our lives for you. So, Lord, I thank you, and we just praise you this morning. And, God, we just celebrate your goodness. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, thank you, guys. We love you. Be blessed today. Be blessed.